went through the basics of how to look at a chest x-ray and the pitfalls, and just to go through the basics. Then we're going to have tea, and afterwards we're going to have a fun session where we're going to have a little bit of an interactive session where it's going to be a little bit of a quiz. We're going to show you some interesting cases where hopefully, besides fun, hopefully there'll be a lesson in each one. And I think hopefully you'll walk out of your family and learn something about understanding, looking at x-rays and imaging in children. So without delay, I'm going to hand over to Ibrahim for the first session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and just thanks to the organizers and Marco in particular for inviting me to speak. I worked fairly closely with Marco and the rest of the pulmonology team, and they have clinical radiological meetings on a weekly basis. And the recurring theme is the interest in how we interpret our chest radiographs. And clearly Marco is very skilled because he does this for a living. But some of you might be unfamiliar with some of the challenges that we face in imaging children in particular. So to kick off the lecture, we're going to address the talk in three broad categories. And depending on time, we'll see how far we get. But the initial presentation and the bulk of the presentation is in the principles of interpretation of the chest radiograph. And it's fairly basic. I've kept it simple. It's much what we teach our registrar on induction and also the medical students, but it addresses some of the important challenges. So, the interpretation of the chest radiograph commences with understanding the clinical context in which the chest radiograph is acquired. Frequently, from a radiology point of view, we interpret the chest radiograph blindly or with a very poor history, so we encourage you to give us as much clinical detail as possible. So, there's an eight-point approach that we take to interpreting the chest radiograph, but one of the most important factors at the inception is to evaluate technical factors. And then we'll address each component of the chest radiograph individually and teach you a systematic way of review. Now, you can approach the chest radiograph from inside out or from outside in, from top to bottom, bottom to top, as long as you address everything that is represented on the chest radiograph. So the technical factors that we're going to discuss under various headings include the identification, so making sure we have the correct patient and that we're interpreting the correct chest radiograph. Technical factors that involve centering of the patient, coning, rotation, what constitutes an adequate inspiratory effort, and then exposure factors and what we mean by these terms. So our technical challenges in pediatric radiology commence with the acquisition. So how do we in fact take a chest radiograph? Unlike in adults where we do posterior anterior projections, in children we generally acquire them in an anteroposterior manner. And as you can see from the photograph, some of these technical challenges are depicted in the first photograph. We usually dealing with a fretful child that's highly mobile, so moving target requires restraint and assistance from various sources, including porters, nurses, people who are not necessarily radiographically and radiologically trained. We often require the assistance of the mother in addition to a radiographer. So with a moving target, these often present technical challenges and in suboptimal radiographic representations. The lateral similarly is acquired usually with the we usually place the left side closest to the form, as in this case is in fact the other way around. Doesn't really matter as long as it's labeled correctly. And then ICU and mobile projections in their own way present a different set of challenges. A multitude of tubing, a child that is suboptimally positioned, an acquisition that may be from the foot or the head of the bed, so they in themselves can present us with the challenges of a suboptimal radiograph to interpret. So then, as I've indicated with those various subheadings, our interpretation commences with identifying the correct study. In the digital era, this is less of a challenge as they're generally linked for us. However, even with a PAC system, sometimes the previous study was acquired by way of a lateral first and then the frontal projection, and the current study may be frontal and then lateral. So you may not be viewing the corresponding lateral with your current when you do comparative studies. So one must always check the identification together with the date, and then also for purposes of issues such as dextrocardia or ICU acquisitions where a child may be position prone, check laterality. So the lead letter, position, and then make sure in the digital era that you're viewing the appropriately dated study. Sometimes in ICU we do 3-4 studies in one day, make sure you're looking at the correct time. The identification process applies obviously to the lateral in exactly the same way. The lead letter on the lateral projection indicates which side is closest to the detector. So those usually influence issues around magnification when one is trying to interpret which hemidiaphragm is which, looking at rib magnification, etc. Centering refers to the position of the center of the beam so that one acquires a homogeneous exposure. So this is more a product of radiographic technique rather than something that we need to bother about. So in a frontal projection, the beam is centered at the interspace between T5 and T6. On the lateral projection, we center the beam at the level of the carina. And this influences exposure factors. Once again, you know, the digital era allows us to manipulate grayscale post-acquisition, thereby diminishing retakes and radiation exposure. Coning is essential to limit radiation. And I haven't addressed radiation issues, but we try clearly to minimize radiation exposure in children who have rapidly developing tissues and whose cumulative dose of radiation exposure over a lifespan places them at increased risk of malignant transformation in tissues. So we try to limit the amount of exposure, but without cutting off essential anatomy. So the center radiograph is one that is appropriately coned, where the regions of interest are adequately represented. The one at the top, we see that the lung apices are cut off, and one could clearly miss fractures of the clavicle or apical pathology. The one on the right, the left lateral chest wall is cut off, the CP angle isn't well represented. This one, the right side of the chest wall is cut off. And in the far left-hand corner, we have one where both apices are cut off. What do we mean by rotation? And this probably represents the greatest challenge in a child who is often throwing themselves back and turning side to side. In adults, we evaluate rotation in terms of the position of the spinous process relative to the clavicles. We can use this in older children, but In younger children, we prefer to use the length of the anterior ribs. And this applies to rotation in a vertical axis. So what we like to see is that the anterior rib end should be at least equidistant. Rotation to either side may simulate pathology within the hilum of the lungs in particular and alter the configuration of the heart. Rotation can also occur in a horizontal plane where the position of the clavicles are altered, but we'll address that in a further radiograph. So this, whilst this is not optimal, if we look in terms of rotation about a vertical axis, we can appreciate that the right rib, anterior ribs are longer than their left counterpart, and hence this child is rotated towards the left side. An easy way of, in an AP acquisition, to decide the side of rotation is to look at the hemithorax that is more hyperlucent relative to the opposite side. So just as an exercise for yourselves to decide, can we perhaps dim the lights a bit more, particularly these front ones?
That little bit difficult because that column there is behind the screen.
Okay.
The switches.
It's just, I'm not sure if everybody can see the chest radiographs project well enough. So just as an exercise to decide in your minds which way this patient is rotated, anybody willing to volunteer? To the right. So clearly that the simple way is to establish which one is more hyperlucent. So the right hemithorax appears more hyperlucent than the left. We can also measure these actually and see that these anterior ends are longer, those are shorter, so the child is turned towards the right. So once again, if you don't evaluate rotational factors, you might interpret that as differential lucency and invoke diagnoses such as bronchiolitis obliterans or ball valve effects from other sources. So I've shown one where the clavicles were projected higher than they should be, and that implies rotation in the horizontal axis. The kids throw themselves back, so the clavicles shift up, and we refer to that as a lordotic projection. So ideally, we want the clavicles to be projected across the mid portion of the first rib. And the clavicle should be positioned at about T1 or T2. This also results in the anterior ribs being directed inferior. In a lordotic projection, the anterior rib ends are projected above the posterior ribs. We also see the clavicles thrown well above the first rib and now come to lie almost opposite C5, C6. And this has major implications in terms of interpretation. If we take the effects of horizontal rotation on this chest radiograph, we can see the clavicles are projected very high, the anterior rib ends almost correspond to the level of the posterior ribs, the lungs look voluminous, the cardiac configuration is almost boot-shaped and simulates that of a tetralogy of fallot, and all this is based on technical factors. Also the hilum are prominent, we often lose the clarity of the hemidiaphragms, and lower lobe airspace disease can also be inferred on the basis of aberrant technical factors. So in fact, when you see a lordotic projection, we always teach that you cannot comment on lung volumes and you cannot interpret cardiac size. And as you can see, the configuration can also be altered and one can exaggerate the appearance of the hilum as well as the effacement of the hemidiaphragms. the interpretation of what constitutes an adequate inspiratory excursion is based on the number of anterior ribs that we can count. So we want at least 6 anterior ribs. The 6th rib should intersect the hemidiaphragm. We usually like to see a little bit of 7, but 6 should intersect the mid to lateral portion of the hemidiaphragm. In adults, we count posterior ribs, and bigger children, posterior ribs are also quite useful. We want to see at least 9 posterior ribs. But in children, in pediatric radiology, 6 anterior ribs is the magic figure. So here are 2 radiographs of the same patient, and one can see the technical issues that arise and might give rise to interpretation that is erroneous. Same patient, adequate inspiration, poor inspiration. Now we have a big heart. We have exaggerated parahilobronchovascular markings. People might interpret that as pulmonary plethora, and you may ascribe an underlying congenital heart anomaly to that patient. Exposure, as I say these days, is less of a challenge because we can manipulate grayscale in digitally presented radiographs. But just for those who might still be receiving hard copy plain films, when you evaluate the technical factors from underexposure to overexposure and masking of pathology, have presented an entire range of grayscale abnormalities. So what do we want to see in a chest radiograph that is adequately exposed, or to what extent should we manipulate the grayscale until it is optimal? So we want to see at least the trachea and the proximal airways, proximal large airways, the left and right main bronchi. We want to be able to see vessels to the at least the outer third of the lungs. We want to see the vertebral bodies through the heart and their respective interspaces. And we want to see the vasculature behind the heart. So that would constitute an adequate exposure. So those are the technical factors we've addressed, and you've seen some examples of how technical compromise results in spurious interpretation of pathology. So now we're going to move on to how do we systematically approach a chest radiograph. And as I say, there are various ways. When I was a registrar, I often went from the top across, went down the lateral chest wall, looked at the hemidiaphragms, went up the other side, came down the middle again, and then looked at the lungs last, and then looked at review areas. This approaches it slightly differently from inside out, as long as you evaluate everything represented. So we'll start with the heart. So what is represented in terms of the cardiac silhouette is outlined by this superimposition. So the SVC and the vascular structures make up the upper part of the right heart border. The remainder of the right heart border is largely represented by the right atrium. RV is not really represented on the frontal projection. LV, LA, the AP window, a bit of the pulmonary, that's the AP window, the pulmonary artery, AP window, and the aorta. The lateral projection, similarly, the cardiac silhouette, we need to be aware of what is represented and what is normal. So when superimposed, we can see that the anterior aspect of the heart and the lowermost third of the hemithorax is occupied by the RV. We also see the aortic arch and the so-called mini arch of the pulmonary artery. We see LA and then LV. When interpreting cardiac size, we've already made the point that technical factors must be ideal in order to measure cardiac size. There's no point in working out a cardiothoracic ratio when there's a poor in spirit excursion, or when there's marked rotation or lordosis. So just to be aware that we use different cardiothoracic ratios at different ages, and we measure the maximal transverse diameter of the heart and then relate that to the widest dimension of the hemithorax. So 0 to 2 years of age, you use 60%. 2 to 4 is 50 to 60%. And over 4, we use the adult ratio of 50%. So out of those ranges, they represent cardiomegaly. On the lateral projection, similarly, we said RV must occupy about one-third. Anything beyond that will represent RV hypertrophy. One is often challenged in this regard because the anterior mediastinum is occupied by thymus that blends imperceptibly with the heart. LV must not extend beyond the anterior tracheal line. So one draws a vertical line along the anterior margin of the trachea, and the LV must not project beyond that. Here's an example of cardiomegaly in a child. If we measure the transverse cardiothoracic ratio, this will exceed the 60% in a child younger than 2 years of age. But more importantly, on the lateral projection, we see this vertical anterior tracheal line extending inferiorly, and then the LV projecting beyond that margin. We also see the effect on the airway that is posteriorly and superiorly elevated. So there are lots of confusing terms, and it's often creates a bit of confusion. Issues around cardiac position. People often use the terms dextrocardia and situs inversus synonymously, and they're really not the same terms. So situs solitus refers to the normal position of the heart, where it's left-centered, or within the center, or slightly to the left. The apex is leftward directed. Oops, beg your pardon. When the heart is positioned in the right hemithorax, but the cardiac apex is still leftward directed, that is referred to as dextral position. That may be due to underlying pulmonary hypoplasia or secondary to lung destruction with volume loss and cardiac shift towards the right side. That's referred to as dextral position. Cardiac situs refers to the arrangement of the atria. Those are difficult to establish on a chest radiograph, but there are indirect ways in which we can establish that. The bronchial configuration usually follows that of the atria, and the abdominal situs usually reflects what's happening with the bronchi and the atria. So this is a child. We can see that the heart is positioned in its normal location, but the apex is leftward directed. It's actually clear on my screen here, but I think the stomach bubble is seen on the right-hand side beneath the right hemidiaphragm. So there's abdominal situs inversus, and here, and if we can evaluate the airways carefully, we'll see that there's probably the left main bronchus is sitting on the right and the right main bronchus on the left by virtue of its pattern of division. So this is a child with dextrocardia and situs inversus. The cardiac configuration can also allude to the underlying congenital heart anomaly. So there are typical configurations, the so-called boot-shaped heart of tetralogy of Fallot. I think the French call it Pouin Sabot. There's also the Tapwer configuration, where one has this typical snowman configuration with total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. There's also the box-shaped heart of Epstein anomaly. So the actual configuration can give an indication of the underlying congenital heart anomaly. So that's basically the evaluation of the heart. Next we move on to looking at the hemidiaphragms. So just to clarify the issue around what we refer to in terms of the summit of the hemidiaphragm. So the right hemidiaphragm is often slightly higher than the left because of the underlying liver. The summit of the hemidiaphragm is referred to as the highest point of the hemidiaphragm on the frontal projection, and that should be at the junction of the medial third and the outer two-thirds of the hemidiaphragm. When there is migration laterally, that implies a subpulmonic pleural effusion. The lateral, people often look to see which one is higher, and that is useful only if the stomach bubble is interposed between the two hemidiaphragms. But the continuous hemidiaphragm, it's not as simple as this is made out to be, is usually the right hemidiaphragm, and the one that is effaced by the cardiac silhouette is the left hemidiaphragm. When one is stuck, you can also look at the degree of magnification of the ribs to decide which one goes to the larger ribs being further away from the detector, and hence it's important to establish was this acquired with the left chest against the detector or the right chest against the detector. So just some examples of diaphragmatic pathology. One can clearly see that this is a newborn child, the nasogastric tube in situ, no stomach bubble in the left, that's clearly visualized, and a large number of expansile cystic lucencies within the left hemithorax resulting in mediastinal shift to the right. So clearly there are a number of considerations, including some of the other congenital lung conditions such as CPAM, but in this case it's clearly loops of bowel that have herniated through a large congenital diaphragmatic hernia. Other examples, eventration, where in fact the hemidiaphragm is not discontinuous, it just has a segment that is attenuated and thinner than and devoid of muscular fibers, and it results in a diaphragmatic hump. Also the Morgani hernia, where we've got an anteromedial a defect through which bowel herniates. I can't in fact see it on the lateral projection. So this eventration is at the top. You can see it's anterior, and we know it's on the right side.
Excuse me,
possible
to use a pointer?
Can you not see it on here? There is a
pointer. Sorry, I thought yes.
There is a pointer on the
pointer. I thought I'm moving the arrow around and okay. So just to point out, so we have a right-sided hump, and we can see that that is continuous, there's no bowel herniating into the chest, whereas over here we have loops of bowel or cystic lucencies behind the heart, and on the lateral projection we see that there's herniation. Okay, so now moving to the lungs. On the frontal projection, it's important to appreciate that very little of the lower lobe is in fact represented on the frontal projection. You will see the pathology of the lower lobe behind the middle lobe. So just in terms of lobar anatomy, right upper lobe, right middle lobe abutting the right heart border, most of what's represented on the left is left upper lobe, and a little bit of left lower lobe. Just to view the corresponding lateral, so on the right side we have a horizontal fissure separating the right upper lobe from the right middle lobe, and what's behind the oblique fissure is the lower lobe. So we only really appreciate this little bit on the frontal projection standing on its own. The rest of the right lower lobe is represented on the frontal projection but behind the middle lobe. So So I haven't gone into segmental anatomy, but on the right hand side, the upper lobe is comprised of three segments, an apical, anterior and posterior. The middle lobe is comprised of a medial segment and a lateral segment, and the lower lobe has five segments on the right, an apical segment, posterior.